This is the story of a working class guy from New York City and a billionaire who saved the Marvel Universe. Also Spider-Man and Iron Man, I talk about them too. Stanley Martin Lieber, born 1922, grew up in a working class family in New York City, living in a one bedroom apartment with his brother and both his immigrant parents. When he entered into the comic book writing world, he did so using his pen name, Stan Lee, because as an aspiring writer, it would be embarrassing to be associated with comic books. Lee developed Spider-Man with artist Steve Ditko, who also came from a working class immigrant family. Spider-Man was so expected to fail by the publisher that it was attached to the final issue of a comic series which was already being cancelled, Amazing Adult Fantasy, which is disappointingly less disgusting than it sounds. But people loved this awkward teen wall crawler and he was given his own series. In its simplest form, Spider-Man is the story of a teenage boy who's bitten by a radioactive spider, and instead of dying from radiation poisoning, he gains incredible abilities, which are not actually very spider-like. He shoots webs out of his hands, and he has precognitive abilities, but he has a spider on his chest. It counts. I grew up watching the 90s Spider-Man cartoon and reading Spider-Man comics, and when the 2002 Spider-Man film came out, I was so excited, I was obsessed. Spider-Man started me on comic books, actually. I collected over 1,000 comics until I was too poor and I had to sell them all. Poverty, which brings us to the main point of the video. Part of what defined Spider-Man from the beginning was his relationship to class. Beyond the weird spider stuff, Spider-Man is the story of a teenage boy who loses his uncle, the person who provides for their family. When Uncle Ben dies, Peter blames himself for not saving him. Aunt May can't afford to pay their rent, so despite being at school full-time and playing superhero to atone for his uncle's death, Peter also has to find a way to support his family. His main source of income is selling Spider-Man selfies to a newspaper which hates Spider-Man.
He's a menace to the entire city! I want that wall-crawling arachnid prosecuted!
He has to put his pride and his reputation aside just so his family can survive. He must be a hero, but it will forever be a thankless job. This has been a pretty significant part of Spider-Man's story through most of his incarnations. The 1967 Spider-Man cartoon portrays Peter and May's money problems. In the 1977 film, Peter spends half the movie desperately trying to borrow money off people.
Would you settle for a poverty-stricken grad student?
In the first episode of the 90s Spider-Man cartoon, Aunt May can't afford to pay the bills, so Peter sets out to get photographs of the Lizard to sell to the Daily Bugle. Bills are a struggle in the current Spider-Man cartoon. The 1973 Turkish ripoff, Three Mighty Men, portrays Spider-Man as a violent gangster, so I guess he's having trouble finding a normal job there too. And then there's the Spider-Man movies, which we'll get to in a little bit. First, let's take a look back at the original Spider-Man comics to see where this plot thread comes from. Peter Parker lives with his aunt and uncle in Queens, New York. They're very invested in Peter's education, buying him science equipment to support his studies, but when Uncle Ben is killed, Aunt May is immediately struggling to pay rent. She starts selling her jewelry to make ends meet. So Peter starts looking for work, any work he can get. He ultimately works as a photographer for a newspaper, the Daily Bugle, selling photos of himself as Spider-Man to pay the bills and keep away any landlords who enjoy threatening elderly widows with homelessness. When Uncle Ben dies, it puts Aunt May and Peter at a significant disadvantage because Peter's a high school student and Aunt May is a woman, and not a young one either. It's set in 1962, and we're to assume that Aunt May has just been a housewife taking care of Ben and Peter for the past decade or so, and she doesn't have a career or any work experience to fall back on. She immediately starts pawning her jewelry, so it seems like she and Ben didn't have any savings. To make things worse, Aunt May is often in poor health, which we know how that goes down in America. But in the newest Spider-Man films, May is young, she's healthy, and a woman of the 21st century. It's a major change from Spider-Man tradition, and not just because Aunt May's hot now. Just by being a woman in this day and age, May is inherently at an advantage which 60s Aunt May just wasn't. Back in the 60s, women weren't even allowed to have their own credit cards. In those days, plots often involved May and Peter's finances, their struggle to make ends meet, and it was part of Spider-Man's initial popularity. In fact, the very first ever fan mail published in Spider-Man cites his financial state as part of what makes him so relatable.
From 2002 to 2007, director Sam Raimi brought us the Spider-Man trilogy, in which class is a prominent theme. Uncle Ben has recently been laid off and is having trouble finding work in a world where technology is changing rapidly.
The corporation is downsizing the people and upsizing their profits.
When Ben dies, Peter is unable to get work, unable to pay his rent, and Aunt May gets evicted because she can't pay the mortgage. Mary Jane, Peter's love interest, also struggles, and while their friend Harry and his dad, the Green Goblin, are well off, MJ faces classism from them.
You think a woman like that sniffing around because she likes your personality? What are you saying?
Your mother was beautiful too. They're all beautiful until they're snarling after your trust fund like a pack of ravening wolves.
The Green Goblin is Peter's arch nemesis, and the contrast between their classes is ever present and glaringly obvious. In Spider-Man 3, the Sandman is motivated by the need to save his daughter because the American healthcare system is like the Hunger Games. In this trilogy, Peter has to balance relationships, superheroism, and the stress of poverty. He's weighing the responsibility of taking care of his community with taking care of himself, and taking care of his community is winning. It's only when he allows someone else to help him, to save him, that he's finally able to properly give to the community without sacrificing a part of himself. There's also a theme throughout the films of solidarity in the community. When Peter is fighting the Green Goblin, civilians turn up to help him out. When he's unmasked fighting Dr. Octopus, civilians promise to keep his secret and give him back his mask. When I was a cynical kid, this felt unrealistic and I hated it, but now I see it as representing what we could be, what we should be, as a community working together, supporting one another. Class solidarity, TBH. In 2012, we got a reboot in the form of the Amazing Spider-Man films. These don't make as much of an issue of class for the Parker family, though Aunt May is working as a waitress and starting to take nursing classes, and Peter is still selling his photos to the Daily Bugle. Money's tighter since Uncle Ben died. The difference in class between the Parkers and the Stacys is emphasized. The Stacys eat real fancy food and dress for dinner. Who dresses for dinner? What the fuck? George Stacy is a police captain and likes neither Peter nor Spider-Man. The cops decide Spidey is a menace and put out a warrant for his arrest. The first film culminates when the police have shot Spidey and he's not able to make it across the city in time to stop the villain. So a construction worker organizes with other workers across the city to use cranes to help transport him there. It's another heartwarming moment of class solidarity. Peter's financial struggles aren't as prominent as in the Sam Raimi trilogy, but he's still very much a working class superhero from a working class background.
Many years ago, in a galaxy far, far away, Marvel sold the Spider-Man film rights to Sony Pictures. So when Marvel Studios began to build their own shared cinematic universe of superhero movies building up to the Avengers films, Spider-Man wasn't allowed to be part of that world. That is, until Marvel Studios and Sony struck up a deal which would allow Sony to keep the rights to Spider-Man while benefiting from having Spider-Man's new films exist within Marvel's cinematic universe with Iron Man and the Avengers.
In the MCU films Captain America Civil War and Spider-Man Homecoming, Peter is introduced to the MCU through his relationship to Tony Stark / Iron Man, a billionaire scientist who becomes his mentor. You see, Tony wants to use the teenager to fight Captain America for his own political agenda. Just a cute little bit of exploitation of a 15-year-old child.
Tony Stark. More like Tony Snow, because he's a bastard. Stark. Snow. It's Game of Thrones.
Stark shows up at Peter's apartment and basically offers him an Avengers internship. Peter's computer and other equipment has literally come from dumpster diving at this point. This kid is poor. But not anymore, because an adult in his 50s is going to pay this child who has to dumpster dive to use Facebook to fight against a team of military trained and superpowered adults for him. Yay. And that's that. Finance is solved. Peter has money from here on.
This doesn't happen in the original comics at all. Peter is a loner who doesn't have a mentor, and that's kind of the whole point, that after Ben dies, Peter is alone and has to find his own way, both morally and financially. In the comics, the most similar character to Iron Man in Peter's life would probably be another wealthy scientist who dresses up in a costume and flies around New York. Norman Osborn, the Green Goblin.
The Green Goblin is Spider-Man's foil. He's older, he's morally corrupt, and he's incredibly wealthy and privileged in a way Peter probably never will be. In the very first ever issue of Spider-Man, Peter tries to join the Fantastic Four because he's hoping it'll be a paid gig. Unfortunately, they're a non-profit and tell him to piss off. That's how Spider-Man first met the Fantastic Four, to pay his rent. A criminal known as the Chameleon realizes Spider-Man must be desperate for money and uses that to lure him to a location to frame him. Peter's first supervillain. In his second issue, Peter is trying to get photos of a villain called the Vulture to sell them to the Daily Bugle to pay his bills, and that's how he meets the Vulture. 2017 Spider-Man Homecoming flips the story of how Peter met the Vulture completely. Rather than Peter and May Parker being the people struggling with money, it's the villain.
I booked this whole place because I got people I have to look after.
The Vulture, aka Adrian Toomes, finds his business becoming obsolete. He's a blue-collar worker with a family to support. Look, his collar's literally blue. He has a business to run, employees to pay, and he's being put out of work. He had a contract with the city. He was meant to be cleaning up after the Battle of New York, but policy changed and his company was laid off, replaced by a company working for none other than Playboy billionaire superhero Tony Stark. He then starts making weapons with stolen alien technology, which people use for things like breaking into ATMs, real high-stakes violence. What a bastard.
If only there were a worse character in the Marvel Universe I could compare him to, someone who maybe like built and sold weapons that facilitated in the killing of thousands of people in Afghanistan. Nah, I can't think of anyone.
As an Avengers intern, Peter is treated like crap, in part because he's a kid and kids are annoying, so it's okay to treat them like crap, obviously, but also, have you never been on a private plane before? Who hasn't been on a private plane? What kind of stupid loser child has never been on a private plane? As an Avengers intern, this kind of makes Peter a member of Stark's private military. This is a child living in poverty who was brought into a private military by a powerful man who literally came to his home, blackmailed him by threatening to reveal his secret identity to his aunt, and made him join his special military force.
In the real world, young people from low-income families are disproportionately targeted for recruitment by the US military, with promises of a bright career and a paid college education. Stark's recruitment of Peter Parker echoes this dynamic because, in this particular instance, Stark really does represent the government and the military. Tony Stark comes from money, and that money comes from weapons. Stark is a genius war profiteer. The first two Iron Man films were co-scripted by the US Department of Defense. To get sponsorship from the Pentagon, usually in the form of being loaned military vehicles, aircrafts, and equipment for filming battle scenes, which would otherwise be unavailable to filmmakers or require expensive special effects, American films which portray the military need the Pentagon's approval, so the military has to be portrayed in an uncontroversial way, effectively turning the films into military propaganda. Marvel's relationship to the Pentagon broke down after the Avengers, but they're back in bed since 2019's Captain Marvel. In the first Iron Man film, Tony leaves weapons manufacturing for the military behind, but soon after, Nick Fury offers him a job working for the Avengers, which is a military under secret organization SHIELD. So he doesn't provide weapons for the US military anymore. He only provides human weapons for the SHIELD military.
But after SHIELD falls apart, the Avengers become kind of his private army. Just something all billionaires should have, one private military for each beach house, ideally.
For the record, I'm not judging. I love the rich. Trickle-down economics, you know? If the rich didn't have all the money, where would we even put it? My girl jeans don't even have pockets, let alone my spandex. Before 2008, Iron Man wasn't an especially popular Marvel character. I remember as a kid in the UK, you could buy Spider-Man comics, you could buy X-Men comics, but Iron Man could only be bought as a package with the Hulk and the Fantastic Four, because that guy was just not that big of a deal. But nowadays, he's one of the most recognizable superheroes out there. Why would that be? According to Brett Pardee's essay, The Militarization of Marvel's Avengers, the popularity of the Iron Man franchise was due, at least in part, to the post-9/11 culture in America.
The emergence of militainment has been a response to the cultural shift of militarization during the post-9/11 era, a time that needed to be secured in stories that would affirm militarized myths. When Tony Stark realizes after being kidnapped in Afghanistan that terrorists are getting a hold of his weapons, he changes his attitudes towards weapon manufacturing and calls a press conference to announce that Stark Industries will no longer be producing weapons and instead decides to turn himself into a weapon so he can personally go to Afghanistan and shoot the terrorists himself, cutting out the middleman. But this ultimately leads to Iron Man becoming an advisor to SHIELD in a relationship which echoes a private military contractor to the US government. Iron Man is like a suave billionaire version of the working class Toomes, the Vulture, right down to the goofy robotic exoskeleton. Just look at his resume. In the first Iron Man movie, Stark worked as an arms dealer selling missiles in the war-torn Middle East before his epiphany, a come-to-Jesus moment, after nearly being killed by his own weapons. Later, in Avengers Age of Ultron, Stark's plan to build a secret global defense program goes horribly awry when the Ultron AI becomes self-aware, leading to the death of 177 people in the fictional town of Sokovia, plus $487 billion in damages. The first phase of Marvel films culminates in an invasion of New York by evil aliens echoing 9/11, but this time, the Avengers are there to save the city, and come out with few serious casualties. This foreign invasion storyline would culminate in the 2018-2019 Avengers Infinity War and Endgame films.
SHIELD in the comics stood for Strategic Hazard Intervention Espionage Logistics Directorate, but these films had it changed to Strategic Homeland Intervention Enforcement and Logistics Division. Where SHIELD's had been a vague but international organization in the comics, they were becoming pretty American. Americans in the post 9/11 era were looking for stories which supported their views on how they mythologized the tragedy. The US as an innocent target of foreign terrorism. The American military was enormously romanticized as a result. So while Iron Man became an incredibly profitable franchise, The Hulk, whose film came out the same year, flopped. Which may be because in The Hulk, the US military is kind of the bad guy.
The Phase 1 films moved heroic motivation away from the individual's responsibility to others and towards the individual's responsibility towards a military organization. Moving the motivation takes the responsibility for thinking about the ethics of conflict away from democratic processes and gives it to faith in military organizations.
No one has actually told me why I'm in Berlin or what I'm doing. Something about Captain America going crazy.
When Peter joins Iron Man to fight Captain America, he doesn't understand what the fight is about at all. He just listened to Tony Stark, who told him Captain America went crazy, instead of explaining their opposing viewpoints on international law.
Whatever the ethical implications are of Peter being involved in a fight like this are irrelevant. Peter's faith is in Tony Stark and the Avengers.
Earlier, we looked at how the original Aunt May was at a disadvantage both economically and socially. But the MCU Aunt May doesn't have much of a narrative except that she ends up dating one of Tony Stark's best friends, the guy who was surprised a 15-year-old had never been on a private plane before.
But even if Aunt May were old and sickly, the MCU manages to completely avoid any repercussions from that because of Tony Stark. If Aunt May were to get sick, Stark could just pay for it, or his friend could pay for it, or maybe he could invent her an anti-sickness armor, which is great if you don't want your audience to question systemic problems related to poverty, like the healthcare system. And we certainly don't want the audience to call into question the rich or the military, because that's exactly what Stark and the Avengers are. And those are the movies that are making Marvel and Disney the most money. You can't villainize your biggest cash cow.
In the newest Spider-Man film, Spider-Man Far From Home, the villains are a group of former Stark employees who felt betrayed by Stark taking the technology they themselves had designed for him and then laying them off. They set up one of their own as the hero slash villain Mysterio to steal back Stark technology.
So in the MCU Spider-Man films featuring the Vulture and Mysterio, the villains are a blue-collar worker whose business was screwed over by Stark, and Stark's own employees who want the rights to their own work. And Spider-Man is recruited by a billionaire's private military program to defend his property against workers.
Contrast this with the villains from the Sam Raimi films, such as the Sandman, who is a criminal because he wants to save his little girl from dying in a country where she can't access healthcare, or Dr. Octopus, whose mind is taken over by the artificial intelligence of his arms. Harry had thought Spider-Man had killed his father. Even the Green Goblin wasn't really necessarily evil, but he was driven mad by his serum.
Not a bad person. Just had bad luck.
In the Sam Raimi films, most of the villains aren't evil, but it's just their bad circumstances. And most of these characters achieve some sort of redemption. Sandman apologizes, Doc Ock saves Peter and MJ, Harry comes around and becomes an ally at the last minute.
In the MCU films, the Vulture and Mysterio are also victims of bad circumstances, specifically Tony Stark circumstances, but there's no redemption. They have more agency than the villains in the Sam Raimi trilogy, as they're not being driven crazy by machines or mutations, but we're not supposed to sympathize with the Vulture or Mysterio because Iron Man good, workers bad. you probably have way more in common with the Vulture or Mysterio than you do with Iron Man in reality. Tony Stark is more likely to be the villain in your life.
One of the tensions within both these movies is that the villains in them are, on some level, right. Tony Stark represents corporate America, and corporate America really does shove the little guy aside and strip the imaginations of its employees for parts.
In the older films, Spider-Man sometimes has a complicated relationship with the cops, but in the MCU, Spider-Man kind of is a cop, saving rich people's property for them, as the cops were designed to do. When Spider-Man was first published, it belonged to a small publishing company written by sons of immigrants from working-class families. Peter Parker now belongs to a massive media franchise and co-starred in some of the highest grossing movies of all time, Avengers Infinity War and Endgame. Spider-Man's last solo film grossed over $1 billion worldwide. In 1998, Marvel was purchased by billionaire, now chairman and CEO, Isaac Perlmutter to save Marvel from bankruptcy. In fact, bankruptcy was part of why Marvel sold the Spider-Man film rights to Sony. But since then, Marvel has become this massive movie blockbuster empire, even bringing Spider-Man back into the Marvel Universe, and Perlmutter has made a nice profit. Perlmutter leans towards the conservative side of things. This is the man who, when Don Cheadle replaced Terrence Howard in Iron Man, said that no one would notice because all black people look the same. Perlmutter reportedly doesn't care for diversity in Marvel because money takes priority. He donated hundreds of thousands of dollars to the Trump presidential campaign. Perlman oversaw Marvel Studios' development until 2015, which would include all the Iron Man films and the first Avengers films. In 2009, Marvel Studios was purchased by Disney, of which Perlmutter is one of the largest shareholders. The only reason the MCU can even exist in the way it does today is because of Disney. The most powerful and wealthy film studio in the world is able to build it. When I was a kid, the idea that Spider-Man could meet the Fantastic Four in film was an impossibility because the Fantastic Four film rights were owned by 21st Century Fox and Spider-Man film rights were owned by Sony Pictures. In just over a decade, Disney has bought Marvel Studios, bought 21st Century Fox, and the success of their films led to an agreement with Sony to bring Spider-Man home to Marvel. The MCU could now totally have Spider-Man go to the Fantastic Four asking for a job like he did in the comic, but that's probably not going to happen. And not only because Marvel prefers militaries over non-profits. I wonder if Spider-Man's class has become a non-issue because if highlighted, it calls into question Iron Man's relationship to his wealth. We don't want the audience to question the idea that Iron Man could exploit the teenage Peter Parker, and we don't want the audience to consider the possibility that Tony Stark might actually be the villain.
The Marvel films can never think too heavily about the amount of power a character like Tony Stark accrues, because to do so would require contending with the degree to which Marvel has run almost all of its closest competitors out of the game, and we certainly can't have that.
I really enjoy the new Spider-Man films. They're so great, they're so funny. But a part of what made Spider-Man Spider-Man had to be sacrificed for this incarnation to even exist. When the stories of the poor are co-opted by the rich, it changes how those stories are told. As media becomes more and more monopolized by massive corporations, the lens through which we get to see the world is going to be changed, not only because of who makes the films, but also because of the intent with which they're made, which is to make as much money as possible. Film studios work with the Pentagon because using military equipment for free is cheaper than renting or computer generating it, and in return, any possibility of the military being portrayed in less than a positive light is sacrificed. Portraying struggles with money, with housing, with healthcare, with work exploitation can raise uncomfortable questions about a system designed to make money for the people at the top at the expense of the people at the bottom. Robert Downey Jr. as Iron Man starred in 9 Marvel films over 11 years, including 3 standalone films. Iron Man was by far the most popular MCU character, and with Robert Downey Jr. moving on to other projects, that has left a space to be filmed in terms of MCU's flagship series. Spider-Man has very clearly been designed as a sequel series to the Iron Man franchise. Tony Stark has designed multiple special super techie costumes for Peter, and after his death, leaves him an augmented reality security defense and artificial tactical intelligence system which can hack anyone's personal devices automatically and kill anyone at any time anywhere on the planet. Just your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. Both Spider-Man films have revolved strongly around Peter's relationship to Tony as a mentor and a father figure, and his taking the first steps into filling Iron Man's shoes, both in the narrative and the franchise. So we're left with a version of Spider-Man which may end up inheriting more from a 2008 war propaganda movie co-written by the Department of Defense than a comic written by Stan Lee in 1962. Well, if you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe. And if you want notifications for my next videos, ring the bell. Thanks to all my patrons, and a special thanks to Aaron, Choi Jerry, Div Arnold, ES, Jamie, Nina, Pregnant Seinfeld, Susie S, and Juicy Fantasy Queen Plant Hookups. And an extra special thanks to Nina and Naya, who let me borrow their roof and freeze to death while being terrified of heights. It was a lot of fun, thank you. If you'd like to see your name up here too, or just want to support my videos anonymously, check out my Patreon, where you can also get some special treats. And thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Thwip, thwip, thwip.